and welcome to another episode of Seeds of Music. I'm your host, Kyle Williams, and this is the number one web show where aspiring independent artists and do-it-yourself musicians can learn right now how to gain wider exposure, grow a strong base of raving fans, and make a living doing what they love. On the show today, we have Shawnee Williams, and she is an independent artist in the contemporary Christian pop music industry. We're going to be talking about her story, what's it like being an indie artist in this genre, what her biggest struggle has been during this whole process, her strategy for building a fan base, and also a little bit about how studying classical music, since she's a classical pianist, how that has influenced her ability to create pop music. Additionally, on top of that, what's cool about Shawnee is that she comes from the corporate world as the human resource officer for a large company, and that's kind of given her a unique perspective when it comes to the music business itself. So stay tuned. All right, guys, welcome to another episode of Seeds of Music. I'm very excited on the show to have Shawnee Williams. Shawnee has been sent over from Chris and Alicia, if you remember our previous interview with the Rendezvous Show with Chris and Alicia. So Shawnee, thanks for reaching out and coming on the show.
Thank you, Kyle. I appreciate you asking me.
And I apologize because for all the Skype problems we were having trying to get this running, but it looks like everything's good. So we're just gonna zoom right through. Hopefully before the internet comes down on our heads. So Shawnee, tell us a little bit about your story and how you came into your music and how you came into your message.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, I started just inspired to start music when I was 5 years old. I went to a Heritage Singer concert and wanted to play the piano after that. And my father started a gospel music ministry, and I did that from the age of 6 to 14, toured all over the country. And,
oh, really? Wow.
Yeah. So that was my first introduction to music, and I was basically the family pianist for the group.
Okay.
And but never really considered myself a vocalist as such, even though I did sing with the group, and that's when I started songwriting. But then in 2008, I went to a Stephen Curtis Chapman concert, and that was really exciting. It just inspired me to go on a songwriting spree.
Okay.
And so then I just started writing again and recording, and that's what I've been doing ever since.
And who's Stephen, for people who might not be familiar with his music?
Stephen Curtis Chapman is a very prominent songwriter and Christian artist.
Okay. All right, awesome. What was like the aha moment where, I mean, describe the aha moment specifically. You're at the concert and then you're going to be a songwriter. What was it like?
You know, it was Cinderella. I think I heard his song Cinderella, and I was just in awe. You know, I was sitting there and all these people, you could just feel the Holy Spirit. And it was one of those concerts where everything did not go right. There was a big thunderstorm, and but the Holy Spirit blessed anyway. And it was one of those, just those powerful moments where, despite all the technical things that happened that night, it was an overpowering spiritual experience. And I just felt the presence of God come over me at that time and just say, you know, this is what I want to do. And I was working as a human resources executive at the time.
Oh,
so,
really?
Yeah, wow. Very different path.
Wow. Well, so how, I mean, I'm curious, like, has your experience like working in HR like affected how you promote your music? I mean, like, because that's like a human relation, right? Music is relating to humans, right? But I mean, that kind of a particular experience, because I don't think many musicians have ever worked in HR. Has that ever impacted how you approach your promotions and marketing now for your music?
You know, probably so. Over the years, I've learned quite a bit of computer skills and, you know, internet research and all. And I'm sure that's helped me in being able to get my music out there on the various sites and feeling comfortable with the technology.
How about like being organized? Does it help you stay organized?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Someone showed me how to put together a media kit and,
yeah,
you know, been going at it ever since.
Yeah. How essentially do you think are skills like that, like being organized and putting together media kits? Because I mean, most artists are stereotyped as being notoriously disorganized. I mean, has it like truly helped you like in being organized?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I just, I think it's important to present yourself professionally. People don't have a lot of time to make that first impression. It has to be there. Nobody's going to spend the time to try to organize your material and make sense of it. So you make it easy for them to just, okay, here it is. So that's what I'm
So it's kind of
trying
like
to do.
if you want it done, you have to kind of do it yourself. Like for some things, not everything, but yeah, it's kind of and a lot of musicians who consider themselves do-it-yourself musicians, they kind of feel like they have to do everything, but you really don't. I mean, you just have to make the big decisions and keep the organization together. So that's I can definitely relate to that, and a lot of people can. So to like the meat of back to like the meat of this interview. I mean, what is it like being like an independent artist in like a music industry that is specific to like a specific religion, like contemporary Christian music, specifically pop? Because I know there's Christian metal out there too, but but you're in the pop industry for Christian music. I mean, what is that like? Do you think it'd be a different experience than being in secular music?
I do think it's a little bit different, but I think that it's very welcomed in the secular arena, as I found, just going to these different websites and putting my music out there. Sometimes I'm the first person to actually put my music in their Christian genre. They've got it there, just ready and waiting, but I'm the first one to take advantage, and I just feel blessed and rewarded by that because it's like the Great Commission, going out and spreading the word. And we shouldn't just be confined to our churches and our own small groups. And getting the word out there in every avenue is very important. And I just think it's one of the most rewarding things you can do.
And what's like been your main strategy for getting the word out there?
I've done, like I said, I'm pretty good at internet research. So I just hear about what sites are out there and just, open the accounts, upload my music, upload my bio, my pictures, and just, be connected between the Twitter and Facebook and Reverb Nation and, just kind of make a circle of a buzz around that.
Okay. And have you experienced like what's been the journey like learning these internet technologies? Do you feel like anybody can and learn it if they work hard enough, or do you feel like you just have to be the type of person who thinks that way?
I think anybody can learn it. It's really user friendly, I think now. At one point it wasn't so user friendly, but now I think anybody can do it. Yeah.
Yeah, probably in the late 90s, and the internet was just well, social media didn't exist then, but yeah, I can just remember a so-called web 1.0 was very ugly looking and not very easy to use. So, but yeah, I get, if you work hard, you can learn. I mean, do you think there's a disparity between creative thinking and more pragmatic thinking? Because most people tend to, I think, feel like most musicians tend to feel that you can't find a balance between the two. I mean, do you find a balance there?
I love both, but obviously music more. But I love computers and working on computers. So for me, it's not really a hardship at all.
Oh, really?
I like to do it. But yeah, I can see it. And some people have a fear about computers and a fear of putting their information out there. And so if you have that, that's I guess maybe a little bit inhibitory. But I don't think it's something you can't. Anyone can overcome if they want to. So.
So yeah, do you mean like fear is just in like having like your information exposed? I mean, it seems like you have to be exposed to have success as an independent artist,
Exactly. Yeah.
You can't just like hide.
Exactly.
What has been your biggest struggle as an independent artist?
Getting the money to record, and I think that's probably a frequent thing that artists struggle with. That's why you see Crowdfunder, you see BeefFunder, and I think there's Kickstarter and any number of them.
Indiegogo,
Make a video and have people support it, and it works for some people. I haven't really gone that route. I've just everything that I've done, I've funded out of my own pocket. And so that's been a struggle just, for the next release. And that's kind of why my last three songs have been singles and not full albums. It's not because I didn't have enough songs for another album, but it's just what I do what I can afford to do at the time.
And how do you actually go about creating the having the songs like recorded? I mean, do you reach out to like your personal network that maybe there's like a producer or an engineer that you know, or do you shop for, I mean, how exactly do you go about that process?
Oh, good, great question. I'm happy to answer that. Bruce Turgon, I don't know if you're familiar. He was the bassist with Foreigner,
I
and
know Foreigner. I don't know the names of them though.
and you could YouTube and see all kinds of his videos and everything. And he has a studio here right in Reading where I
Okay.
live. And so somebody mentioned it. I'm like, no way, he's not in Reading. And so I checked it out, and that's where I recorded all my releases. So I keep going back because it's such a great experience. It's not an intimidating environment at all. It's very relaxed, and Bruce is very detailed and really pays attention to every detail of the production. I just feel really blessed to have him so close to be able to do that. So.
What advice would you have for someone who wants to go the route of recording their next single but paying out of their pocket and not doing a crowdfunding? I mean, what would be your key points of advice for them?
Have it up front if you can before you go in, because projects have a way of ballooning. You go in and you're like, wow, this would sound cool if we did this or that. And for me, it's if I can't finish it, I don't want to start it. So I make sure that I have the resources up front to see my project through before I get started. And I don't know, that just seems like a good policy to me. That way you don't end up with things being strung along or, not finished.
So just have it all up front. What about actually in the recording process?
As far as how to go about recording a song or what.
Yeah, just from your experience, like what has been like the biggest hang up that you hit when you record a song?
I think it's just maybe overproducing it because once you get going, it's like one idea feeds off the next. And it's really easy to get carried away and maybe overproduce the song and do too much. But to find the real the meat of the song so everything is complementing each other and really bringing out what you want to be brought out,
Without
it's a
overdoing it.
yeah.
So basically being able to say the song is done.
yeah yeah
We're not touching it anymore.
exactly, Kyle. Yeah, absolutely.
Do you play a lot of live shows?
I don't, I that's a goal of mine. That's something I wanted to do now that it's just me. I did start had started to record Wait to Grace with Grant Williams and did that album with him, and now I'm just doing the singles on my own. So I do have the ability to do some smaller setting type performances with the equipment that I have, but I really feel like I need to step that up, and I'd love to like open for some groups or do some more live performances. It just has to be economically feasible for me to do that.
And what would be the biggest challenge about making it economically feasible? I mean, are you gonna reach out to people to invest that are just like, I guess, investors, or reach out to your personal network? I mean, how do you plan on approaching that?
I'm not one to really go that route. I'm very independent in my thinking, and so I'll probably figure out a way. The thing that I struggle most with is actually scheduling the gigs. I don't like to do that part.
Oh, really?
Computer for promoting myself or the writing and recording and performance, but When it comes to scheduling the gig and
Yeah.
getting that together, I think that's really my weakness.
Okay. Are you
So,
your own manager?
yes.
Okay. So, so that's like what you have to do. You're just like, I don't.
That's the thing.
That's a tough part. All right. Well, at least you know like what, at least you're like aware of where your weakness is and you know where to focus on, and that will like help. Improving that weakness will help improve your career overall. What about do you work with promoters?
I've been blessed just to have, people like Alicia and Chris who are tweeting and then you who are doing this video. All of that is so helpful to me. I'm just thankful.
Excellent.
And this year, for some reason, the radio, people coming in wanting to play my music on the radio has
Okay.
just been like exploding. And I just feel really blessed about that.
So you've made a lot of headway just with the internet alone and its avenues. Like you haven't necessarily had to turn to like traditional media outlets or deal with promoters, which can be pretty shady at times. So you've actually been able through the internet to kind of circumvent that, which is awesome. I want to talk a little bit about like your piano playing, just because you studied classical music. I mean, how is and you and you and you but you're a pop performer in the essence of it. Like what, how is studying classical music influence your ability to create pop music? And would you suggest that other pop musicians do the same?
Definitely. Classical music has just helped me develop so many skills, piano wise, that I would not have had if I'd just done pop. And it just, I don't know, for me, it's all the, I guess I should back up a little bit. when I was 8 years old, I was given a special gift. My grandma passed away at the end of one of our concerts, and she had been actually accompanying our gospel music singing group. And at the very end of one of our concerts, she laid her head on her arm and passed away right in front of a very large audience in Hayward, California. And we had concerts lined up for months to come and no pianist. And so my dad was like, "Lord, please, you got to help us here. We've got all these concerts lined up and no pianist." As we went from church to church, we would rely on the pianist that was there to try to learn our music right before the concert. And it was very difficult on a young family because, I was eight.
Young,
I was six and on, and I had been learning from my grandma. I had about 2 years of lessons, maybe at that point. And my dad prayed, and it was just almost a miracle, I would say, in that I was able to suddenly read all the music that we were doing at the time, and I started composing and all of that. And it was just truly a gift. No teacher would take me on at that time. I was this little squirt, this little thing. My dad built a platform for because I couldn't reach the pedals, and I had to wear high heels in third grade so I could reach the pedals on the piano.
Wow.
It was quite a sight,
You didn't
but
like tape wood blocks to your feet?
yeah. And but I, was all over the piano at a very young age, and but I needed that technical guidance and discipline, I guess, that I didn't have. It was all very natural and self taught at that age. And so my dad took me to the university, and a professor there named Dr. Robert E. Bowman took me on. He was the only one who would take me on and teach me, and he taught me classical music. So
Really?
that's kind of the background on that.
Why were teachers not wanting to take you on?
They just said that I was too advanced, and I was, I was just given this incredible gift at a young age of piano.
Okay.
So,
So maybe they didn't think you were as moldable, like, 'cause you weren't. Like, maybe it was like the Jedi thing. You're just too old to train or whatever. And but you're 8 years old, but really they wanted you when you were 3 or 4. Because I imagine classical is hardcore like that. They're like, oh no, you're seven. It's way too old. You're like an old, you're like a grandma at that point to them. Yeah, that's a pretty incredible story though, to say the least, and just the fact that you're able to come out of, it's kind of like the difficulties are really what force you to achieve like greatness in your own way, and I definitely see that as like a great achievement, even for a young age like that. And I've listened to a couple of your tracks, and you had, I think it was the track "Wake to Grace." Did you have this like? I was like, aha, I hear it all in the intro. I was like, wow, it's very enjoyable. So Shawnee, I have this like one last question. It's a really awesome question, might throw you for a loop. What is your favorite album, and what would your life be like if it never existed?
Oh yes, you did throw me. You did
Yes.
throw me. Oh boy. Favorite album.
I can go for
I
like 10
guess
minutes. I'll just be back. I can figure.
I would say Bruce Turgon's "Outside Looking In."
And what would your life be like if that didn't exist?
Well, I think it just it spoke to me. It gave me a different perspective on it was just kind of a reflection also of how I felt at the time, because it came out in 2005, but I didn't hear it until 2010.
Okay,
So
so it's wow, it's a really new album. Most people, they say they on the show, they'll say old albums, they'll name something. It's like from, well, I mean the 90s. The 90s is old, right? But usually it's pretty, it's never something like past 2000. That's cool.
yeah, but I had been in the corporate world and working for corporate America, and now I was kind of on the outside of that, doing music and doing my own thing, and so I guess it kind of spoke to me from that standpoint, as I wasn't in the mainstream corporate world anymore.
Yeah.
And also, as I mean, if somebody really was to look at the lyrics on that album, they're very complex, very detailed, and as a songwriter, I really admired that, to see that kind of depth in the writing. So
Which is not in the mainstream corporate
I
world. By implication, yeah. Gotcha. All right, well, Shawnee, this has like been another awesome interview. I wish you all the best. And guys, check out her links below. Also, I think you're playing a show here in Hollywood soon, aren't you?
Well, actually, I'm just attending the awards. I'm a
Attending awards. Okay.
nominee, so I'm
Okay.
going to be walking the red carpet this Thursday.
Hey, awesome. 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 So what's the best way for people to connect with you? They just you have ShawneeWilliams.com.
ShawneeWilliams.com. Yes, and if you join my mailing list, then you'll get all my updates.
Okay, awesome. So guys, make sure to do that. I'll have the links posted below. And Shawnee, thanks again for coming on the show Seeds of Music.
Thank you, Kyle. I really appreciate the opportunity.
Okay, awesome. And you were the first interview with the new microphone.
Yay.
Woo!
Thank you.
Look,
Love
it's clear. You can hear this clearly. All right. Thanks again. See you later. And that wraps up another episode of Seeds of Music. We had Shawnee Williams on the show today. Make sure to check out her links below and give your support. Next, sign up for the email newsletter if you haven't already. Head over to seedsofmusic.net, punch in your email, and stay up to date with the latest happenings at the show and never miss another interview. If you liked this interview, felt like you really learned something valuable from it, make sure to like it and share it on any social media platform that you use. Lastly, comment on the video. What was your greatest takeaway from the interview? How will you apply what you've learned? And who would you like to see interviewed? You can email me at kyle.seedsmusic@gmail.com. Remember, we are the future of music.